you're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. Thank you for keeping it urban. Today we are talking about food security and the state of livelihoods under COVID-19. Our guest tonight is the Executive Director, Food Rights Alliance, Madam Agnes Chirabo. Chirabo, when we broke off, I was bothered by the question of whether there is a correlation between food security or food per se and managing healthcare systems, because you hinted on it somewhere that it is because we have a certain element of food systems, that is why probably we are thinking our healthy care is strong or our immune system is strong because we have food varieties. So what is the correlation between food security and healthcare management?
You see, when all students graduate in the university, where there is, in that particular university, they have a school of medicine. The medical students on that graduation day, before they are declared, they take an oath. It's called the Hippocratic Oath. Hippocrates is the philosopher behind the whole study of human medicine. And Hippocrates said it, "Thy food shall be thy medicine."
Thy food shall be thy medicine.
Thy medicine. And the failure of that, then thy food, thy medicine shall be thy food.
Okay. If you fail to make food your medicine, then medicine will become your food.
And truly, you know that many of us, you have a portion of medicine for breakfast, a portion of medicine for lunch. They say 1 times 3, 1 times 8. When you failed on the equation of thy food being thy medicine, we can actually cut the health cost to more than 60% or 70% if we manage the food system properly. And we encourage Ugandans and the people in Uganda to feed themselves adequately. Just look at COVID-19. COVID-19, the coronavirus is a virus, and therefore it might take longer to get a vaccine or even cure. The gist of the matter is in the therapeutic aspects of food. We were watching patients that were discharged, and they were telling us through various media interfaces that they were being given vitamin C. And actually, we have learned that in the countries that have highly been affected by this pandemic, the cost of vitamin C tablets has gone up. And they are becoming scarce. But for us here, we are swimming in vitamin C the whole day. We don't need to put a burden to the government to go and stock vitamin C tablets. When they are hawking oranges, citrus, you know, all sorts of citrus, you know, the fruits are rotting, the pineapples are always go through one day here, the hawkers are there holding 10 of them, 8 of them at 10,000, and they are pleading, please. The other day, I saw a very frustrated woman again in Wandagaya. She's pleading to every motorist to take some ginger home. A whole basket, can you imagine 10? Or even if there were 5. Whole pineapples, cayenne pineapples, we are throwing away. The vegetables, this morning I found a hawker on a bicycle with a very big bunch of leafy vegetables, and I was like, and somebody who was with me laughed at me and said, "See, your food is now moving on the bike." We have all of this. And by the way, many of us have not been hospitalized, not because we don't have the virus. You recall the Ministry of Health was saying many people are asymptomatic. They have the virus, but they can't. But even some of us who lived in the days of real living, They could not treat you for a flu when you're young. We would play with our flu around and what, because
there is a mango that you
there was
eat.
A mango, there was a passion in the morning, there was jackfruit, there was, you know, mom would do a steam of vegetables, and those ones were a must. You first eat them if there was meat, to give you a piece of meat. We're having all this. So there is a philosophical relationship, if we go by Hippocrates. And by the way, the medical people, I appeal to you, don't forget your philosophy. That philosophy is not mine. It is your philosophy. That's why you take an oath. So we need now to reinstate the food and nutrition units in hospitals. Some people just need to be, not to be sold tablets. By the way, we shouldn't trap our people into being clients of pharmaceuticals. Because every time you're taking a tablet, you're a client of
a pharmaceutical company.
Yes. And you're an enemy of the backbone of your economy. So I appeal to the medical people. Look at these people, and some of them just tell them, go home and buy 5 pineapples and eat one every day and come back on Tuesday. Teach them to go back and eat the food.
But then
the
pharmacies and clinics will have to close.
We shall deal with them. Let me tell you, the unfortunate bit, every form of medicine has after effects. So after you have dealt with the illness, you have to deal with the drug. So what do we want? You cannot tell me that I be kind to the pharmaceutical companies when I'm putting my government at stake, borrowing money. Now they are here, they are putting hospital beds in Namboli. I don't know if it is true or it is not. I don't need to put that whole burden to my government when foods are rotting everywhere. Everywhere. And let me tell you, if government encourages, you remember, the president said if he's going to rebuild this country on a firm ground, on a rock ground, and it becomes a real economy. Issue number one he mentioned was food. So I'm supporting the president. It is going to be easy. And you know, if we are going to rebuild this economy to become a real economy, and issue number one is food security. It is not about talking about it and we clap. No, it is about doing it. And how are we going to do it? Tell the Ugandans, everybody, every day in the fight against COVID-19, before you look for your mask, have you taken a lemon?
And interestingly, yes. Chirabo, this message seems not to be coming out. I would say, apart from a few politicians that have indicated that food is very pertinent in the fight against COVID-19, the government is concentrating on masks and sanitizing and social distancing and locking us down. I don't know why and how do you come into play, you as Mama.
You see, we adopted measures. And because the pandemic came here while nobody was ready, and we shouldn't give that as an excuse, because we had information way back in 2019, the last quarter of 2019, so we cannot say we weren't ready. We just chose not to be ready. We just chose not to attend to trends and then give the country alternatives. So we should stop giving that as an excuse that we weren't ready. But you see, we adopted measures from where the pandemic started, where their food system is completely broken down, and all the hope they have is in the pharmacy. Duka ya dawa. So we adopted. And when we adopted, even we haven't had a time to learn. So for us, we are coming here to say we have done very well. It is very good. But all of these measures are external. Wearing a mask, you wear it externally. Sanitizing and washing hands, you wash the hands externally. Tonsembelela, it is external. But the virus requires internal measures. And the internal measures are in food. The beauty about food is that it helps the already sick, and it also helps those that are not sick. So why don't we go for a cheaper remedy? We go for a cheaper remedy such that these people in their masks, they don't cross to the health sector to be admitted in Namboli. We can't afford to sustain a COVID-19 ill patient. We can't afford it. If we are here saying, oh, now testing voluntarily, you pay how many? 240. We cannot afford. So we need to work out a strategy of making sure that so many people don't cross that what? That line. And the magic is in a fleet of foods that are rotting everywhere in this country to build their immunity, but also those that can rehabilitate the damaged parts of the body. It is scientific, it is evidence, it is not an effort at Ewolokoso. It is all over. So let us go for the cheaper option, that's one. But also strategically, may I look at my country in providing solutions to the people, but also strategic positioning. We must emerge as Uganda, as a giant, and we tell people.
Do we still have that chance?
We do still have it. We do still have it, we just need to harness it. The problem is most of our people were schooled in a market kind of market economy business. They were given those theories and they don't think about. Yes. They are looking at making the market rich at the cost. At the cost of our abilities, but also our future, our sustainability, our sovereignty as a state. We still have, I'm against government borrowing. But if this money that is coming in here is given to our scientists, not to look for a vaccine, why are they labeling? To profile our foods. To profile our foods, and you know, look at all those things that WHO want to listen to, they won't, because they are captured by the market. But anyway, invest in our scientists. And then we go out to tell the world that this is how we are fighting. Me, I don't mind. Even if they come out and say all of the 40 million Ugandans are sick, there is no problem.
For as long as they have the right food to eat.
And the next day we said they were all sick, but none of them died. And we did not use your vaccine. Do you know that COVID-19 is a global market deal now? For us, we are here, miserable. We're not saying, oh, sorry, Vanange. I saw the Minister of National Guidance the other day wanting to cry, pleading to us, oh, you people. The other side of the world, people are striking deals. And you must have seen now US has shifted its battle from China to Russia.
Russia is threatening to release a vaccine.
So it's a great market deal. And let me tell you, these guys are going to push another loan down our throat. They are going to, after striking their deal, we are going to give you so many billion dollars in vaccine. None of those dollars is going to step in Uganda. They are going to send boxes of those vaccines and they give money to their pharmaceutical companies. So for us, let us do a foodutico. Let us invest in a foodutico. Hey, why are they investing in their pharmaceutical?
Chiyabo, has COVID-19 in any way tested Uganda's resilience in terms of food security?
It has. It has in terms of governance. In terms of governance, greatly, greatly challenged. Because how would the Fountain of Honor pronounce to give food and it takes forever to come? That was an insult. It was an insult, and Mr. President, you should not forgive all those people around you. They are not supposed to embarrass him. He offers to give beans, and they give out stones. He offers to give his people food, and 38% of the food was not fit for human consumption, and somebody who supplied it is still walking scot-free, that means we haven't given the governance of our food system what it deserves. How? How? Do you know what it means? You supply to government food that is not fit for human consumption.
And you
walk scot-free, you want to make government a murderer. Do you know what can come out if somebody can prove beyond reasonable doubt?
Are the people that got this food at risk?
Of course. And we are talking, you know, President these days in COVID wants to talk science. There is scientific evidence that aflatoxins cause liver cancer. And therefore, that's why the Bureau of Standards were saying that this food was not fit for human consumption. But consignments had gone out.
We went ahead and distributed it.
We don't know the one that was not fit for human consumption, what happens to it, but we also don't want to know. But they only tested for aflatoxins.
But this was food that was grown by Ugandans.
The food was grown by Ugandans. The food was managed by Ugandans. But for me, what makes me very annoyed in terms of governance, the food was given to government to give it to its people. So when I'm talking about that COVID unveiled how there are little or no governance systems when it comes to food, it was evidenced. It was evidenced. The farmers have been crying over and over again. Let me also speak to this. This food that was given to government and later tested not to be fit for human consumption in those percentages was picked from the market, where people are buying food on a daily basis.
So it speaks of a bigger picture.
And until now, I have not seen a fast-moving action to say we are heading in to danger.
To the market and find out, because it speaks of a
how?
Bigger danger.
How? How? You know, our Cancer Institute and its ability and capacity. Yes. And then we got that liberation. You know, it was the president told us, be in the house, close, and listen. So I listened. After we had seen the headline that 38%
of the food
was not fit for human consumption. The next day there was a new headline. I think it was 28. The headline had changed it. You say like you would say 28% of the food was not fit for human consumption. That means 72% was good. So the next day the headline changed. 72% of the food that was distributed was fit for human consumption. I said, it is good the president told us to close our doors inside and listen. But nobody.
But 28% is a significant proportion.
It is a significant proportion. But I have told you, that was tested on aflatoxins alone. There are the macrotoxins. But to make matters worse, even metal, because the bulk of the maize flour on the market is being milled by non-food-graded machines. Had they tested for metal, I doubt if they would give out any cup of maize flour. But that is not the issue. The issue was, that was a very big revelation to government that, hey, wait, this food is picked from the market where all people buy food. So that means we are going to burden the Cancer Institute. We moved on. The attempt we did was to turn around the headline and make it positive. So these are all, now they got to this end. Because for years we have been pleading about the access to agricultural inputs. We have been pleading, everybody, Even the elite farmers, the satellite farmers, I know many of them who bought bean seeds and they went back after investing so much, all their savings. Everybody has been pleading. We have been pleading that the national food reserves are called strategic food reserves. You see? And that is why there is a conversation in the World Trade Organization, the conversation on public stock holdings. It is something very strategic. It is not obscene. Somebody told us it was obscene, and you also don't want to associate with it. It is strategic in nature.
Well, Chirabo, you're talking of building food reserves and all these things, but you are one of the champions, people that are against the GMO bill, which is meant to aim increase of production. So, I mean, you're neither here or there. You're walking in what they call these days rubber-dubber style.
No, you can't rubber-dubber on that. Who told you that those who bought our food reserves, why did they buy them? Who told you that they are input? What are they selling there minus GMOs? You see?
So you don't think, because the GMOs are already on the market, wouldn't they be regulated?
I know by law they are not. And whoever is dealing in them is dealing with them illegally. So I want to go by official information from government. We don't have a law. So, you know how hazardous a mosquito is? Huh? You know. But if you find it on your leg, do you cut it with a panga or an axe? And this is what we are talking about.
You can even blow it away.
This is what we are talking about. If you're having weak systems that cannot even assess beans that are going to be given out and you end up giving out stones, don't come afraid that you're going to regulate science of that nature. Don't. By the way, the whole world today is on its knees because of a biological weapon.
So we don't know what we are dealing with when we talk about GMOs.
Let me tell you, the challenges of production and productivity in Uganda are not in any way related to the kind of seed the farmers are planting. Perhaps the only challenge associated with seed is the fact that they were sold a food grain disguised as a seed. And so it did not germinate because it was not prepared as a what? That is the only challenge. But it has nothing to do with the productivity of the kind of seed or the kind of animal a farmer in Uganda is keeping.
Chirabo, as we are winding up, that brings me the question of the notion that we are actually not food insecure. It is just a question of food distribution.
Of course, that's why I told you. That's why I told you. Let us address all these mainstream challenges. Let the burden of food, perhaps after production, stop being an issue of the burden of the farmers. We take strategic importance in our food and we organize our food system. We make sure that the state takes responsibility in ensuring that the seed that goes out is actually seed, that when a farmer plants it, it brings out what? Food. Let's make sure that the soil testing kits are essential agricultural inputs. Some people, their soils have no problem, only that they are planting wrong crops into right soils. So we make all of this streamlined, and then we make the food, the way it is distributed, a strategic issue of importance. My dear, we did not sell our food reserves because we had no GMOs. I don't want somebody to associate that with. You need to read articles of even farmers, because of COVID, how they are pouring their milk. They are just opening taps and there are rivers of milk flowing. You here, you have even failed to market the little milk that is coming from the animals you're condemning. You can't market it. Highly nutritious, from grass-fed animals with high fat content, we have failed. The pastors have been crying for years. And you're here saying it is because of the kind of animal they are keeping. What exactly are we talking about?
You know, my thinking would be that, probably we need to improve the breed, say, of our animals. But, I mean, how are we going to do this without going scientific?
All science is not wrong. Because even farmers were doing science, they would spot a good bull or a good he-goat from the neighboring sub-county.
I think they
so
still
science
do.
Is not new. But also science, we should stop looking at it as an end in itself. It's a flow. It's a flow of ideas. It's a flow of ideas. And that is why I sometimes get annoyed if somebody slaps me a form of science as an alpha and omega. Yet we know that science is a flow of ideas. But let me also tell you that science is not free. And science is not for fashion. It's on purpose. And therefore, if we are to take farmers to science, it's very good, but not as an end in itself. The rest of the aspects have to work. I have told you, there is no reason why a farmer should invest more in increasing productivity in milk when she failed to sell even the little milk. It doesn't make logic. Panang, let us not let our farmers hang. Simply because we are following rhetoric conversations to find to sound important and well educated. We shouldn't. Science should be done on purpose. But even the little they have done, you have failed to let them see it through. Surely. My mother has a heifer. And these days when I'm asking about her heifer, I ask her, how is your fertilizer factory? Because that is the only value she's getting.
Fertilizer,
the dung. The poor woman calls you, she has mobilized all her monies from the milk and waiting for the next artificial insemination. She says, now Musawo has told me that for this one, I'm getting a heifer and I have even paid him more. We wait. I found my mother weeping. She had paid in anticipation that she's going to get a heifer. The doctor had told her that if you want 60 semen, you pay so much. She paid. She was away for her hospital routines and the grandchild called her to tell her, Mom, Kitiwa has given birth, but to a bull. Everybody in the family was sad. And I know my mama is not alone. There are so many of them.
Thousands of farmers out there who cannot be helped by the system.
She has been trapped into science. She has gotten to believe it. It is not regulated. It is not working. She feels cheated because she was told to pay so much to get so. She didn't get. So, for me, I'm saying if we must go science, we must be ready. And we should work across the entire stream, not partly, and then we jump out, partly and we jump out. We are going to see farmers committing suicide because you introduce them to a technology that requires good investment. They go
but you
in,
are not there. As
you're not there to provide the safety net.
Chidabo, the conversation on food can never end. We really thank you for making the time.
Oh, it is bad that we are ending on a sad note. But food remains food, whether it is produced for home consumption or for the market. And because it remains food, it should meet the minimum standards. We should not promote any food because it is for the market. It must be safe, it must be acceptable, it must be nutritious, it must be that one requires to live a nourished life.
And with that, we cannot continue this conversation. Thank you for watching The Checkpoint. Be sure to catch us tomorrow, same time. Good night.